It starts with a gust of wind in the frigid Antarctic. As the barometric pressure drops, the wind speed increases. The wind roars across thousands of miles of open ocean, organizing the chaotic sea into long bands of pure energy. Southern Ocean swells. These southerly groundswells march up the South African coast and bend into the perfectly contoured point of Jeffreys Bay. Jay Bay is a geographic fluke. It is the world's greatest right-hand point break. No question, nothing can compare. When a deep south swell, 10 knots southwest wind, and a medium low tide, the result is perfection. A pure line of ocean energy that can be ridden for over a mile. You can take a picture of something you see. The wave itself is thick, fast, and powerful. The sensation of speed is incredible. Each turn can be a 25-yard long arc. The wave is so perfect that it immediately shows up anything lacking in style or in approach. The wave is very easy to ride, but extremely difficult to ride well. My name is Sean Thompson, and over the last 35 years, I've been intimately linked with Jay Bay. Born and raised in Durban, South Africa, I first surfed the wave in 1968 when I was only 12 years old. The shortboard revolution had shaken up the surfing world, and my cousin Michael and I, escorted by father Connie, were on our way to Cape Town to compete in the South African Surfing Championships. It was our first safari away from home, and my father decided we were to stop off for a week at Jay Bay on the way down. I remember arriving in the evening and checking into the town's only hotel, the beach. We were 600 miles from home, and my cousin and I could barely sleep, thinking about the possibility of perfect surf the next day. The next morning, we woke up to a perfectly shaped 46-foot swell bending into the point. Totally empty, just us. The three of us paddled out alone, and my enduring memory of Jeffreys Bay is of the perfect waves I rode on first day so many years ago.
From where you paddle out, there's a perfect keyhole where it's like man-made. It seems like something you draw in your art class in high school. Where there's a keyhole where you paddle out right in front of the wave. From the keyhole, you can catch a wave, and you can ride it down to a keyhole, which is like a football field away, and you can get barreled the whole way across. If it's big enough, you can catch it from the same keyhole. You can go about 3 football fields length on one ride. It's one of those waves where it's so inviting and you think you got it, and then as soon as you think you got it, it outraces you. So the whole time you have to stay on your toes. And the guys that do surf good out there, it seems like they're always have a really big bottom turn to project them into the front of the wave.
The best way to ride Jay Bay is by flinging that pure line on the face and through the tube. Each turn, each maneuver must mean something. At Jay Bay, less is more. The surfer becomes an artist. You write your own story, paint your own canvas, carve your own pure line with style, rhythm, and power. It is the ultimate way for free expression.
A lot of guys, like, you know, wait for the right section and then they do the huge maneuver. And when you see that huge maneuver be done when you're not ready for it, that's the thing I love about Jay Bay. you expect someone to go, oh, you look at this section ahead of the, you know, they got, and then they do this huge maneuver and then it sets them up for the, you know, the epic tube ride on the next section or whatever.
Even though it's such a perfect wave, it is a tricky wave. You got to take different approaches off the bottom. Sometimes you got to climb and climb barrel and hit it, or sometimes you got to do a running floater. Other times you got to come up and do a horizontal carve. Sometimes you got to come square off the bottom. And you always have to be mindful of what the next section's doing. Is it running? Am I going to pull back in? Is it, you know, is it going to slow down? So there's like, you know, all this mental work that goes into to surfing the wave. I rode a wave there 2 years ago that was about 2 minutes and 35 seconds, one ride.
You can see it kind of wrapping around and you're always looking towards the next section, but the thing I enjoyed was you just draw a high line, you get tons of heat, come around a section, and it's one of those ways where you just want to keep on, just keep pedal down. You got to keep the speed going, but there's certain sections where you can kind of fade and get locked into the tube, and I mean, there's nothing like watching Andy Irons or Kelly Slater or Bruce. When those guys paddle out and surf, it's like they get speed from what I don't even know where they get it from, but it's incredible watching those guys at the level they're at surfing a wave this good.
When the offshore wind howls, the surfer can hang high on the face, holding an impossible trim while a wall feathers 50 yards ahead of him. Hold the trim, hold it, and then let go, flying faster than ever before. Feeling every inch in your board's bottom bed and feeling the fine, smooth texture of the waves through your board and through the soles of your feet. I've surfed Jeffreys Bay many times since that first day back in 1968, and many things have changed. Back then, we were in fact riding only the tail end of wave. We'd sit out in the lineup and watch these grinding tubes wind down for about a mile before they'd get to us. We called the spots south of us indicators, and we all thought back then it was too fast and too dangerous to surf. It wasn't until the next year, 1969, that the real Jay Bay was discovered, ridden, and eventually renamed Supes. Seen here in this video, in early 1970, my cousin Michael, along with Wayne Lynch, armed with the new shortboards of the era, were some of the first surfers to ride this extremely fast section of the break. Jeffreys Bay has been ridden for around 40 years now, and the place went from just a small village to a successful town with growing businesses and a booming real estate market. Two South African legends both claim to have discovered Jay Bay in the early 1960s. John Whitmore, a renowned surfboard shaper from Cape Town, maintains he told Bruce Brown about the spot when he came to film the original Endless Summer, and Bruce ended up at the wrong spot. Max Wetland, one of the fathers of South African surfing, claims he found the spot after speaking to Bruce Brown about it in Durban.
Bruce told us that on his way up to Durban, where the Bolex camera, in those days, they were winders. And he was filming a wave or waves on what Robert August and Mike Hansen were riding. His camera would run out, power, on the wave. Couldn't get the whole wave in one wind. And we were doing the same thing. Wow, where was that, Bruce? He's telling us, Cape St. Francis.
Bruce Brown had missed Jeffreys Bay by about 20 miles. However, he had discovered a completely different world-class right-hand point break in Cape St. Francis. This spot would later come to be known as Bruce's Beauties.
A few weeks, a few months later, a few of us got together. Hey, I've got to get down there. Got to find this Cape St. Francis. We had never been there, although John Whitmore had told them to go there. We got to Cape St. Francis, and it was just dead flat at the place he told us to go. There were no waves at all.
At the time, Max did not know that Cape St. Francis was an extremely fickle break. In reality, it only breaks 4 to 5 times a year, and it was an absolute miracle that Bruce Brown had found the spot on the best day of the year.
we had spoken to John Whitmore again, and he said we should look at a place called Jeffrey's Bay. There's a Mr. Kutsia there, and he makes wonderful fish and chip shop there. So we drove up towards, from the town, up this direction, to the end of the road, where there was a big fence, and there was a farm. Saw the magnitude break and thought, oh, boy, this is no good. Got in the car, turned around, started. And halfway, when we got across the little river here, started heading up the hill a bit, had to get out the car for a leak. So we got out the car for a leak, standing there, you know, talking about the waves we've had, and gee, you wonder where this place could be. And we saw the point from the road, Jeffrey's Bay, and there was a swell, white water at the end of it, and it went forever. We knew we had missed it completely.
Max Wetland returned to Durban and spread the word about his discovery, Jeffrey's Bay. He returned each year along with more and more surfers, and by the 1960s, Jay Bay was on the map.
When I started living here, if you saw three cars in a day, it would be a lot. There was no traffic or anything. I mean, it was really just a little fishing village. This was all farmland, and there was a guy at the gate here to pay money to come to walk through the land to get to the beach.
So obviously when you first arrived here, it's like it was a surf adventure, you know. You arrived here with a dirt road into Jeffrey's Bay, and when we saw the waves for the first time, we were just stoked, we were awed. It was amazing, and we saw supers for the first time. We didn't really see, because our equipment wasn't really geared up for that kind of surf in the 60s. You know, we just come from the longboards to the shortboards, and so we mainly surfed tubes into the...
Richard Farrelly was the first world champion to surf in South Africa. He'd won the world title in Australia in 1964 and was invited out to give an exhibition at South Africa's first surf contest in 1969. He shaped his own innovative boards, had a beautiful style, and got us all stoked when he flew down the line at 100 miles an hour on his little speed board at the newly discovered section called Tube.
You had to have a gun, a semi-gun that could go fast. And most of the time you were surfing in the wind. You know, you had to draw good, clean lines and make long. Most of the guys probably came here with shorter, more stubbier boards, and obviously would end up ordering boards. The local shapers, there's always been a few shapers, not as many as now, but there always was a couple in town, at least three.
In the 1970s, Jay Bay was a centric scene. It was the epicenter of escapist youth culture. It was South Africa's Woodstock at the beach all year long. Max Wetland had moved down by 1971 to shape balls, along with one of the country's best surfers from the 60s, Anthony van den Heuvel. The community of surfers started to develop, and their free and easy ways ran headlong conservative Afrikaans culture that dominated Jabe at the time. Drug busts, beatings, and general disapproval by the community of the surfers' free and easy lifestyle. Revolution
Summer! They were all coming here, wanting to surf it, while the farms. So finally the farmer gave up and said to his son, what are we going to do? So he put it up to the real estate people and started selling land, because we were encouraging him to do that. And he never looked back.
One of the great surfers that left their mark on Jay Bay in the mid-70s was Australian Terry Fitzgerald. He's called the Sultan of Speed, and his Hawaiian-influenced style fitted perfectly with Jay Bay's roping long walls. Fitz swooped from section to section, carving some of the longest, smoothest, most stylish lines ever seen at Jay Bay.
Look on the face with a concave. If you stick your concave right, you can actually go past the vertical. And to hit that point and hold it, I think that's such a high-risk line to hit and hold. You know, that's probably the apex of where I was trying to take my surfing, not only at the time, but now.